Well, thank you so much for joining me, Jennifer. I
Thanks
have
for
a
having me.
little bit of favoritism for your name, by the way, because my sister's name is Jennifer.
Pretty common name, although I'm probably older than your sister. But the year I was born, I think for 5 years, right around the time I was born, it was the most popular name. There's a lot of us.
There is a lot of you. So I
Mm-hmm.
so it's easier to remember, not forget the name. So it makes it easier. I mean, there's a lot of Catherines too, but like a lot
That's
of
true.
different spellings. And
That's true.
I wish my name was Liza, because then I'd get a song for myself. You know, it's like Liza with a Z, not Liza with an S. Liza. That's really the only reason. But somebody
That's
right, it's Catherine with a K, not Catherine with a C. It's oh, I just did it. So
There you go.
that was like a very pathetic start to this, but
Well, we could start for real.
yeah, this is the real one now. This is the
Yeah.
real. Okay, well, you know, I think this is a really interesting topic to me, because what you went through, you know, and I'm sure you've talked about this a lot, but you know, you were working at a corporate job at Levi's. I can't even pronounce it, apparently. But you know,
The
one of
Europeans call it levies, so you can do
Levi's.
that
Okay, because
too.
I'm technically European, so you're
You can
born,
do
so yeah, I can do it. So I can mispronounce words all over the
it.
place. But you know, I you were sort of on that path to potentially becoming CEO, and then you weren't using social media very much, and then you started using social media, which is you know, as anyone knows, is very dangerous for all sorts of reasons, including, you know, addiction,
Yeah,
but also for
sure.
saying, you know, saying the wrong things and people digging up your tweets. But I'm kind of curious, A, what changed for you that you started using it in the first place? And if you could just give us a little bit of a brief overview of,
Sure.
you know, of that, of the history of that, and what caused you
Sure.
to become more outspoken.
Sure. Yeah, and I had used social media. You know, I had a book that came out in 2008, and that was sort of my first foray into social media because it was sort of newer at the time. But of course, your publisher's like, you got to get on social media. I'm like, I don't know how to do that. But I didn't, I didn't have a large following. It was mostly pictures of my kids on Instagram. You know, that was kind of how I mostly used social media. But I switched and got more active in 2020. The sort of backstory, the short version for those that don't know it, which I'm sure as many as I had worked at Levi's since 1999, started as an entry-level marketing assistant, worked my way all the way up the corporate ladder, which as a woman in the 90s and the 2000s was not a particularly easy thing to do. It was a very male-dominated culture. I was sort of like a reluctant corporate person, but you know, I was good at it and life happens and then I'm the sole support of my family and you know, I'm 10 years in and I don't really have another choice because I'm the breadwinner and so you keep going and I did really like some parts of it, you know, and I really didn't like other parts of it, but I kept going and I loved the company and the brand. You know, I'd worn Levi's since I was 6 years old. So, you know, it was easier to kind of work there than maybe some other company. Anyway, I was a longtime employee, close to 23 years by the end of my tenure, and I worked my way. I know, which is like crazy in the world today. Nobody does
Yes.
that.
No
It's
one.
very
Yeah.
unusual. No one does it. I was very loyal, and I became the chief marketing officer in 2013 and held that job for 8 years, which is a really long time for that job. Most people get fired in about 18 months. I helped the company go public and helped bring the brand back from near bankruptcy, honestly, in 2011. And then I got promoted to brand president, which is like the kind of heir apparent role to the CEO. So I was like doing really well. People liked me and I had a lot of great contributions. But in March of 2020, from the very beginning, I lived in San Francisco, very left-leaning city. I was very outspoken about restrictions on children. I was opposed to all of it, lockdowns and everything, but I focused my advocacy on children because I thought it was sort of like a bridge building issue. Like I thought we'd all be able to agree that we shouldn't hurt children. You'd think that that wouldn't be political, but boy, was
Right.
I wrong. And I I switched from Facebook to Twitter because Facebook, I just ended up getting into fights with family members and that was just too toxic. So I went somewhere that was far more toxic where you get into fights with strangers. Twitter, and I had a Twitter account. I just rarely used it. You know, I used it somewhat in the past to tweet about Levi's things or my book, or I produced a film that came out in 2020 that has nothing to do with any of this. But I didn't have a large following. What I did, one of the reasons I went to Twitter is I was looking for community, right? Within Facebook, it's a closed circuit kind of thing. It's your family and right. your friends and maybe your high school friends and people you haven't seen in a while. Whereas Twitter, you can connect with like-minded strangers. And I had a lot of questions and I was very curious about COVID and if what was being reported on was fully accurate. And I went down this rabbit hole of reading all these medical studies and I would reach out to the doctors. You know, you can DM a stranger on Twitter and they might write you back. And I had a lot of questions, detailed questions, you know, were children really at risk? Why are you writing this? What are your findings here? What is the fatality rate? How do you know that? And so really the reason I became more active to answer your original question is I was just seeking community and understanding. I wasn't trying to, you know, fuck shit up. I was looking for, because I felt I was the only one other than my husband in San Francisco that had questions. You know, we were the only ones. Everybody accepted every mandate, every restriction, everything without question. And not only without question, but with near total enthusiasm, because it became this like religion that I will stay home forever and lock my child in their room because I am a good person and I am virtuous. And if you don't agree with this, you're horribly racist murderer. So I was looking for community.
In part, it was also perhaps a way of gaining control over something that felt out of control for people. And here were these tools, whether they were effective or not. So it was easier to sort of follow that than not. So I think that was probably also something that played a role.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
In people accepting the restrictions. Yeah, I think so. I mean, I've mused on this in general, and I think that given the mass secularization, at least in the United States, I'm not sure that's happening in Canada, but I'm guessing it is. I don't think that changes the fact that people aren't sort of part of organized religion as much as they used to be. I don't think it changes the fact that we still have a religious impulse as humans. And, you know, what is that religious impulse? I mean, I don't have one. My husband jokes I have less of one than anyone he's ever met. But I think this idea that you want to be part of something larger than yourself, that you want sort of a prescribed list of a construct for how to be a good person. Do these things, follow these rules, and you are good and moral and virtuous. They want to believe in something. And I think this was that for a lot of people. I think without religion, and I say this as an atheist, I think we're a little bit lost, you know, and I think we may worship false gods, not just in terms of public health, but, you know, I think it even enters into the worship of, or the celebration of corporate executives as some sort of altruists, which they're not.
Or celebrities and things like that.
Yeah, exactly.
I can see that. I think a lot of people bring that up as, you know, as some of these trends that we're seeing, you know, what people do refer to as wokeness and things like that as being sort of a replacement for religion. I do see that connection to some extent. You know, I also, you know, as somebody who's not religious either, I think maybe there's a few things at play here. I think also loss of community, you know, is a big part as well. Yeah.
I agree. And in many instances, religion provides that in some places. But there is a real loss of community, and it got way worse, obviously, during COVID when we were physically separated from each other. And I think the degradation of our interactions is quite severe at this point, having experienced close to 2 years of only online, sometimes anonymous interactions.
Right. And what you were saying, I was thinking about, I'm just thinking about the sort of how the social media aspect of the internet got started. Like in the beginning, there was this excitement actually of being able to speak to strangers. I mean, I was such a dork that the first time I remember having an interaction with a stranger over a chat was like I was playing chess on my like orange and black interface. And I was playing chess and then somebody typed something to me in a chat box, and I was just so excited. I ran over the house and like, oh my God, there's a stranger, you know, in another city talking to me. And it was just the most exciting thing. And I was looking to connect with strangers at the time. And, I was completely oblivious to some of the dangers and was very innocent about all this stuff. Mm. And then I think there was, especially when Facebook came around, there was this trend actually towards closing these networks. And it became about, having these circles of people that you knew. So it was these,
right.
You know, they were maybe rather large, but they were people that I'd met,
right.
And I work in the entertainment industry. So there were people in journalism. So there were people that I knew. And you wouldn't really let people, so there was more exclusive. And then we went back almost like to Twitter, as you were talking about, you were able to suddenly reach out and expand your community. And I found the same thing where it was really during the pandemic that I was engaging much more with, quote unquote strangers on Twitter that wasn't doing that before.
Yeah. I mean, I had had an experience sort of in my early days of using social media that was very negative and very unexpected because it was early and I didn't kind of understand, the same way you're sort of surprised someone you were playing chess with. But then it actually turned into something very positive. I had written a book in 2008 about the abuse in the sport of gymnastics. It was a memoir and I was an elite gymnast as a child. And it came out in 2008 and I talked about physical, emotional, and sexual abuse of the sport, all of which are rampant. But in 2008, nobody wanted to hear it. And I was viciously attacked on social media by people I knew, mostly closed circuit, former national team members, people I trained with. Maybe I didn't know them, but in that community. And it was, to say it was startling, it was really traumatic because I didn't know, it was 2008. I didn't really get it. And that was really, really tough. And, you can get obsessed and reading all the horrible things people are saying about you. Now I know just not to look. I don't look at any of it. But then I didn't really. And I was getting threats and all sorts of my publisher was getting threats about me. I was a liar and a grifter. This is before Me Too. So you didn't have to believe women. You could not believe women.
Right. Yeah. Until Me Too. Then, you shouldn't believe.
Yeah. Right. No. And now you only have to believe some women. But it was interesting because the first couple years were really bad. But then I had all these girls and women reaching out to me from sport and dance to say, I read your book and it really helped me. And now I've gotten help and I realize it wasn't my fault. And so those were strangers, but from my, community that I knew. And that was really moving for me to know that despite what I had gone through in terms of the serious dragging across the internet, it actually helped some people. They read the book and it helped them and they sought help out because of it. So social media is good and bad.
Oh, absolutely. And I'm still trying to figure out, okay, how much do I engage and, reading the mean comments and which I, have been getting more of. It's like, it's kind of tough and there is that impulse to want to clear the record. I think that's the biggest impulse.
Yeah, I think you can't.
No.
Right? You can't clear the record. They think what they think and I tend to just really at this point, I don't read them and engage very much, which is sad because I miss a lot of the positive ones too, but that's fine. I say what I want to say and I skedaddle. For the most part.
Yeah. And I think this is something, a conversation I had recently, because sometimes the engagement, so I used to more so would take sort of the challenge of taking somebody who kind of attacks me on something and try to engage with them in this very specific, intentional way. And I've sometimes been able to convert them. right? From somebody who attacks me to actually somebody now follows me and is surprised by the transition, and they've reevaluated their thoughts. And
wow, and that's the dream.
That's the dream. But the problem with that is that it doesn't scale. So I can't sit there and be like,
that's right.
Is it enough to reach one, two people? I don't know. You know, I genuinely don't know. There's something that kind of says, well, maybe it is enough to reach one or two people, but sometimes, but at the same time, I don't know that I could sit in front of a computer all day and do this. So I can't. So
no,
scaling is a problem.
Yeah, you can't do that. You can't have one-on-one kind of conversations and, you know, responses all day long. I'm sure you have better things to do than that. I will add that, you know, I don't think I sort of finished this part. In my outspokenness at Levi's about restrictions on children, I started on social media, but then I got some attention and I did start writing some op-eds and like local papers, and I was on the local news and I was leading rallies and attending school board meetings. And then eventually I was on Fox, the Laura Ingraham, the Ingraham angle. That was in early 21. And so, you know, while people point to kind of Twitter as what got me ousted from my job, which I ultimately did get ousted from my job about 2 years into my advocacy, it was more than that. You know, I was present in lots of places and ways. And honestly, the appearance on Fox certainly accelerated the criticisms from within the company and the employees who just literally wanted my head.
Yeah, I can see that. And actually had a bit of a similar experience where I've had to sort of decide whether I would go in something like that or not. And at the time I had resisted that, but in retrospect I've changed my mind actually on that, where I think
when I decided to go on in March of 21, you know, I was part of a group, kind of a grassroots group of open schools moms from across the country, and we had done our darndest to try to get on, you know, the quote-unquote mainstream media, because there were always people on, you know, the teachers union heads and public health leaders, and all they talked about was how if schools opened, all the children and teachers would die. And no one was talking about the harms that would happen if they didn't. And this is a year in, right? Like, we already saw that our kids were suffering. We knew that emergency room visits for young people were skyrocketing. And they would not hear that point of view. And, you know, collectively we had reached out to CNN and the New York Times and, you know, all sorts of quote unquote mainstream platforms. And so when I finally got asked, would it have been my first choice? No, but it's a national platform. She had been great on this subject of kids. And why can't I talk to someone that I disagree with on other stuff? And, you know, that's been part of my message, is I will talk to anyone. I don't care if we disagree. I'm sure you and I agree on some stuff and we probably disagree on some stuff, and who cares? You know, to this day, I would go on MSNBC, and I think they've been atrocious on everything having to do with children and COVID. They have spread fear. Everything they've said, literally everything, is wrong. And I would still go on. You can't talk to a person you disagree with. I mean, that's part of the problem. So I went on. I have watched it several times since. I would say it all again, and I would say it to her. I have no issue with it. And you know, for all the folks that then became enraged in my workplace, screaming, well, many said, we don't really have an issue with you said what you said. We have an issue with who you said it to. We now think you're a wolf in sheep's clothing. You are not one of us. You are one of them. That's what they said to me. One of them being the people that watch her show. And I'm like, but you saw it. So you're one of the people. Like, it doesn't even make any sense.
But they hate watched it.
I know. I mean, it's the number one cable news network in the country. And interestingly, Tucker, which I've also been on a couple times, is the number one show for Democrats 25 to 54 in this country. Are they all doing Oppo research? I doubt it.
That's really surprising. That's really surprising that that's the case, specifically with this show. But I do. I mean, this is where I've arrived to what you just said, that like you should be able to talk to anybody as long as you were able to clearly express your views. And I think right. that's more the standard. Also, I've heard from so many people where they're really not able to, you know, no one else wants to talk to them. So they kind of go on these shows. But I think that really is not even the biggest issue. It's really what you said, like as long as you can say what you're going to say without being censored and you have sort of the fair yeah. opportunity to present what it is that your points are, then yeah, you should be able to say these things to anybody and have these conversations. And that kind of division is really what's hurting a lot of the conversations.
It's the whole, I mean, it's kind of the whole problem, right?
Yeah, it is.
You are either good or you are evil. And that can be, you know, if you do not line up 100% and tick every box in the of the orthodoxy of the Democratic Party, of the left wing woke orthodoxy, then you are the opposite and you are an alt-right QAnon lunatic. Oh, and that also includes, by the way, even if you tick every box, if you talk to somebody or associate with someone that doesn't tick every box, you are also evil. And they sort of further this policy of, you know, you must disconnect and disassociate from anyone that is not on our team. Otherwise, you too are on the other team. I mean, one of the challenges I faced during my 2-year conflict at Levi's was I was also getting in trouble for things my husband said. Because right. he was very aggressive, more so than me in his tone, which is just who he is. So what? And I was very focused on children, as I said. He was outspoken about vaccine mandates, which I was more hesitant in the beginning. But even just about the effectiveness of the vaccine, and he's been right every step of the way. Regardless, he didn't work at the company. Who cares what he thinks about anything? Like, am I not allowed to have, like, what if my dad was a Trump voter? Does that mean I don't, and was outspoken about, does that mean I don't get to work at a company that is left-leaning?
Yeah, I found that actually pretty remarkable. And there was recently a media personality who she said that her parents got banned off Airbnb. I think it was Lawrence Southern, or I don't remember.
Yeah, her last. I saw that.
Yeah. And I thought that was just extremely, that sets like an extremely bad precedent, because the idea that like your family, like you're not responsible for what your family or your kids or your friends say, that is, well, maybe your friends, because you at least pick them, but certainly not your right. family, you know? So
well,
the
I mean,
idea,
the idea that it's an HR violation because someone in your family said something that is against sort of the policy that the company has is not even a policy that's like about the employees or about the brand or the business. Like I can see if you're an executive like I was and your spouse yeah. is out there talking about how Levi's suck, that would be a problem. That's not what was going on, right? That's not what was happening. And it's untenable.
Completely. Well, and you were advocating, you know, one of your main stances was that you were advocating for schools to reopen. And, you know, so a few questions on that is like, why sure. was this the hill that you chose to die on? And at the time, did you know that might be the end result?
I definitely did not know in the beginning. I definitely did know that it might be probably by the end of 2020. What complicates matters, though, is I got promoted in October of 2020 to brand president. So, you know, while there was this conflict and this constant urging and telling me to stop, there was also acknowledgement that I was quite good at my job. So, yeah. You know, that complicated things. But certainly by 2021, I was like, I may not be long for this world. We'll see. Why was it the hill I chose to die on? It seemed, oh gosh, there's so many reasons. You know, one, I grew up in a really like horrible, cruel, abusive environment. Not my parents, but the gymnastics training. And I know that children are silent in the face of cruelty and abuse because they want to please the adults around them. And I wish that some adult with common sense had stood up for me in that situation, because I endured some pretty horrific abuse, as did all my teammates. And no, you know, we were just used, you know, we were children, child athletes used to further the reputations of adult coaches and USA Gymnastics executives. And so there's that piece of it. The hypocrisy, you know, a few months in, the private schools opened. All my peers were sending their kids back to private school in person. They all talked about how their children were suffering at home from the isolation. And these are kids with every, you know, privilege you can imagine. And they were still suffering. And yet the good sort of lefty stance was to demand that public schools stay closed. And of course, these, you know, private school parents in San Francisco are all, you know, in this house, we believe signs in the yard and black squares on Instagram and sort of fake lefties. But at the end of the day, they wanted what was good for their kid. And then they wanted to pretend that they took this sort of good moral stance in favor of teachers' unions. It was just so hypocritical. And yeah. The other reason it was, you know, it was clear that there was harm being done. I mean, some of the people I met in the early days on Twitter were doctors, ER doctors, who told me about as early as May 2020, you know, the suicide attempts and how the emergency room was full of teenage girls with suicidal ideation. It seemed very clear to me and didn't take too much imagination to understand that there were a lot of children left home alone if their parents were hourly wage workers. My kids went to public school. I knew that their friends were not all, you know, okay at home alone. And I couldn't believe the lack of imagination that people seemed to have, that they could not imagine the unsafe circumstances that many children were in because they were home by themselves without reliable Wi-Fi, perhaps in crowded living spaces. And that school, in fact, for many children is the place that's the safe place.
You know, I actually had temporarily taught during the pandemic. I taught high school, and I started out actually over Zoom. And you know, part of it is like, well, I was scared, you know, and especially since I was seeing my parents, and you know, I was scared of the virus. And another aspect of it was, you know, I'm not a morning person. I didn't really want to commute. So I thought, well, man, that's really convenient for me. And it was really difficult, and it was difficult to connect. And then when I said, well, I'll do part of it over Zoom and then I'll go in. And they were very excited when they knew where I was going to come in. Once I came in, and I was going to still split part of it Zoom and part of it in person, but once it came in, I understood the reality of that and how different that was. And after that, I just came in every day that I was teaching, and it meant so much to them. It was just night and day, and you realize the extent. So I think it did very much bother me when people kind of diminished the idea that it's the value and how it's just fine. And the kids are very resilient. Like, it's one thing to sort of make the argument that, you know, hey, it's very dangerous, or, you know, you're exposing people. You can make these arguments maybe, but you can't sort of, and I'll use the word gaslight, because essentially that's right. What was happening when you're talking right. about the masking, and you're talking about the, and how that's no big deal. That is a big deal. I know that, you know, not having the facial exchange, the human connection, was a big deal. You can try to justify that as a protective measure, and you can have that argument or conversation, but it is, you can't dismiss that it is an issue for a lot of people. If it's not for you, fine. And the right. fact that it's a very different experience to learn over Zoom than in the class, that is also a complete gaslighting, because for those kids, I know from personal experience, it was nothing the same, and it was completely different for me. And the connection that we had in the classroom was entirely different.
I know,
and I needed that.
It's, Yeah, it's interesting because people would scream that, you know, all I wanted was a babysitter. And it was so the opposite of that. It was like, no, I know how valuable it is for my child to be in the classroom with you as a teacher. I don't think of you as a babysitter. That's why I want my child in the classroom.
Yeah.
You know, I have four children and they're a wide range of ages. They're right now they're 22, 19, 8, and 6. And so I was seeing it in real time at this, you know, wide variety of ages. And my son who's 8 now started kindergarten on Zoom, and it was a joke. I mean, it's a cruel joke for a 6-year-old to like sit there waving.
You can't even imagine. I had teenage girls and it was still impossible.
And, you know, that yeah, I mean, the teenagers just didn't get out of bed. They kept the screen closed, and you know, we all know, we've been teenagers. School is your life. It's where you find out who you are, and you know, figure out, you individuate from your parents, and you figure out how you're going to be the person you're going to be. And you get adult support that isn't your parents, which is very necessary as a young person. And it's like everything we knew about adolescence, we threw out the window. And to your point, it's the gaslighting that was just so, like, I wouldn't have supported this either, but why not say, okay, we realize this is really tough for kids and we realize the isolation is tough, but it's necessary. No, it was, if you even brought up that it was hard, you were an evil murderer monster. And here's the other thing, in San Francisco, it wasn't just schools that were closed. Playgrounds were closed for 10 months. All outdoor activities for kids were closed. So skate ramps were filled with sand, basketball courts, the hoops were taken down, beaches were closed, hiking trails were closed. So you literally were forced to stay home. No one has a yard in San Francisco, you know, and you know, I had a nice apartment. I was an executive. It was still, it's just, you can't do it with children. And that was just the most cruel, horrible thing. And we used to take our kids to the playgrounds and we would jump the fence. You know, they were cordoned off and people would call the police on us.
And you wonder why, right? Because what is the harm? And people do it because why? You know, that impulse is very interesting. Right?
They were told to do it. They said, yeah. You know, they were told there was a special number set up to call in San Francisco if you saw people breaking the rules. If you saw someone, you know, because you weren't allowed to mix households. If you saw someone going into another person's house, if you saw someone outside, you weren't allowed to mix households. You could go outside, but only with your own household.
People complied with these things, and then that they would not just comply, but that they would complain on call on someone else is really so something.
Disturbing.
Very disturbing.
It's like the Stasi in East Germany, or it's like, I mean, it's McCarthyism. It's really crazy. And I never thought I'd see it in this country. I never thought I would. And it really has damaged my kind of trust and faith in people.
Yeah. It highlighted a lot of things that I wish it didn't, in a way. Well, it's good to know, but I just mean that it brought to the surface a lot about human nature and compliance, which I think it's disturbing.
It is. It did help me once I sort of understood that this is just human nature. Throughout the course of history, probably, I'm going to make up a number, 70% of the people are just going to comply. They're going to be obedient and do as they are told, and they will do terrible things in the name of following orders. And we sort of always knew this throughout history. We've known it through various studies like the Milgram experiment, but to see it and live it was something else. I just never really thought that I would. And I'd experienced in a smaller way, you know, in gymnastics. Because if I described to you some of the things that were done in the gym, that, I mean, you know, I was forced to train on a broken ankle for over 2 years. We had food taken away from us. Our weight was announced on the loudspeaker when we were as young as 12 years old. I mean, just like terribly. And I mean, that's outside of the sexual abuse that was happening outside of the gym, the cruelty and abuse. And everyone just accepted it as normal because we were told by the coaches that this is tough coaching and this is what it takes to be a champion. So even the parents accepted it. And so now anyone outside of that world would think that was kind of crazy, right? But no one else was allowed a peek inside. They just saw the girls performing at the, you know, competitions, bouncing around and smiling. So I had some understanding of it, but not to the scale. I mean, the entire world fell in line. And it was very lonely to be a person saying, wait a minute, this doesn't make any sense. What are we doing?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Well, you know, and you were, you know, you started speaking out about it and, you know, obviously there were consequences and eventually you lost your job. You know, what are your thoughts about, you know, whether employers have the right to control speech by employees? Because, you know, I can kind of see both sides of it because, after all, it can have potentially negative consequences on them, right? Especially when it's an executive who's a higher up executive. There is, their free speech can have an impact on the company because there could be threats of boycotts, which I believe was the case in your situation that they have to sort of contend with. So you're speaking for yourself, but at the same time, it can come across like you're speaking for the company. So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah. Well, it never came across as me speaking for the company because I never said I was with the company. And in fact, it's interesting, until my book came out a few months ago, a lot of people who followed me said, I never even knew you worked at Levi's. So I was very careful. If I did a television appearance, I would say, I just want the chiron to say mama for you. Cannot mention that I work at Levi's. They would say, oh, you work at Levi's? Like, nobody knew. And there were a few random trolls, to your point, who tried to get some traction with Boycott Levi's, which never worked. Our business was doing great, in large part because of the work that I was doing. So I hear you. And yet I had no contract that said I could not speak out on social media. The business was not being impacted. We had chosen to reject and ignore prior Boycott Levi's, you know, campaigns, which had gotten much more traction. You know, Levi's has been pretty assertive about safer gun laws. I mean, millions and millions of people were angry about that and saying they were going to boycott Levi's and no one cared. So my issue is that it's viewpoint discrimination. Mm-hmm. And I think if I can't do it, a well-liked employee of 23 years, a public school mom, why do we think a everyday regular, you know, mid-level manager is going to be able to do it? I had influence in the company. I was doing a good job. I just think it's a really dangerous thing. Can you ask people to sign their basic rights away because they have a job in a company? That feels untenable to me. And the last thing I'll say on it is the hypocrisy of this coming from Levi's is what really, I think, has resonated with people since I've, you know, been even more outspoken. You know, the campaign we ran, which was my campaign, was called Use Your Voice. It's like, you know, we said we cared about, you know, we did all the hand waving and arm waving about equality and fighting for racial justice and denouncing our white privilege. And I will tell you, there is nothing more structurally classist and racist than keeping the public schools closed while the private schools were open. So the hypocrisy of it all is why I would not back down. That and the children.
Are there cases where you think it's not okay for someone to speak when they are employed at a company?
I think that if it somehow impacts how you lead and manage and interact with your peers. So let's just say I was saying overtly terrible racist things online, which I wasn't. I mean, I was accused of racism for saying open the schools, but there's not a clear connection in my mind that that's a racist to say. If I were saying really terrible, horrible, racist things, and I have a team of 1,000 people, which I did, and many of them are people of color. I have, you know, Black team members and Asian team members. And I'm saying, yeah, then I think that's a reflection of me as a leader. And I think it means I'm not going to be able to capably and credibly lead an organization. It impacts my job. Me talking about public schools needing to be open, how does that impact how I do my job?
What if it doesn't impact your job, but the perception of the company? So, I mean, there is a lot of cases where CEOs have been under fire for saying things that didn't represent the company in a good light. And as a result, they were kind of forced out of their companies. Because, you know, of the opinions that were reflected, or maybe, I don't know, maybe they were like a Trump voter or something like that. I mean, it could be worse, maybe, but yeah. Like, there's certainly situations.
Sure. I think it is complicated by the fact that in this particular instance, I was right. Children were being harmed. And so, you know,
but what if you were wrong?
Right, but I wasn't.
Right. Well, I think, and you know,
I hear you. And look, they did have the right to get rid of me. They did get rid of me. And I had the right to say, I'm not taking your money and I'm not staying quiet. And I think this is censorship and I think it's really dangerous. You know, they had the right to do it. It's a whatever at will employment state. They had every right to tell me I had to go. And I had every right to say, you're wrong. And this was wrong. And you're hypocrites. So it's sort of, I guess, working.
Yeah.
You know, if I were the leader of the company, so if I were the CEO and not the president, and there were a few angry employees, because at the end of the day, it wasn't a lot of people. There were a couple angry employees that were constantly writing the CEO and the head of HR. The other thing is the head of HR was quietly telling me she agreed with everything I was saying, but I couldn't say it, which again, enrages me. All he had to do was say, I get it. This is upsetting for some of you, but Jen's a mom of four. You have an opinion. I support your right to say what you say. I support hers to say what she says. Let's get back to business. We're not talking about this anymore at work. We're going to talk about the work. We're going to talk about how we're going to sell some jeans. And it would have been over. That's what the CEO of Netflix said to his employees when they got all mad about, you know, the fact that he wouldn't take Chappelle off the platform. He said, we're going to run a lot of stuff. If you don't like that, you can leave now. And no one left. And it was over and they got back to work. It's not that hard.
And that's the kind of leadership that I think it would take to kind of stop a lot of this stuff. It's kind of interesting because you're speaking for yourself. But, you know, in the past, it used to be a lot more private. And now, you know, it's a lot less private. And I guess when you were invited on these shows, did they invite you because of the following you started getting on social media, or was it because of the following you had because of your book on gymnastics? What was sort of their motivation?
No, it was the following I had because of being outspoken about COVID restrictions. Mm-hmm. Most of the gymnasts who liked me for like 3 seconds. At first they hated me when I wrote my book. Then they liked me when Larry Nassar went to prison, and then they hated me again. And they actually started a petition. There were 50 of them to have me fired, and they would call the ethics hotline, but there were all of 50 of them. So it definitely wasn't gymnasts. It was because of my outspokenness on COVID, and not one time did any show ever mention that I worked at Levi's.
Yeah, that's an interesting aspect of the case that I wasn't aware of. And that I think makes a pretty significant difference. And then, you know, it seems like it's the silent minority, the loud minority that's really making the calls here at a really big company. It's also interesting from a legal perspective, this idea of like, can an employer restrict your speech when you're essentially off the clock and not working, which I guess in a you know, at will employment state, I guess they can.
Yeah, I mean, the complicated thing with my job is, I worked in a global job. I was kind of always working. I'd get up, I had a team in Asia. My job, in terms of managing those employees, started at 5 o'clock every day and went until 11 p.m. And so, there's breaks in the day. Maybe I took lunch. Maybe I'd tweet. Like, it's hard to say this is the work day. I mean, I worked all the time. I never stopped working. I had something else I was going to say. Oh, yeah. Here's another interesting, while we're discussing this particular issue. At one point, I did tweet something about there was a recall election in California, the governor, Governor Gavin Newsom, in the fall of 21. And people were unhappy with his management of COVID and lots of other things, and a recall made the ballot. And I really didn't talk about this publicly, but one time I posted an article about it. It didn't even have a point of view. It was just something about there being a recall. And I was asked to not speak about the recall. Now, this one in particular, that's political speech, which is the most protected form of speech. And there is a personal connection between Levi Strauss and Company and the family that are the majority shareholders and the governor. So it is not impossible. In fact, I think it's quite likely that it came from his office. Now, that is a violation of the First Amendment, if that were the case.
Yeah, that is amazing, actually. I mean, here's the other thing is corporations actually do express their free speech in a way, and they express their stances on so many issues, right? Like they talk about abortion and gun control and LGBTQ rights and so much more. And it's like some views are clearly acceptable and some are not. And I'd love your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, and that's what I mean when I say it's viewpoint discrimination. And I had been a part of many of this. I had always been very proud to work at Levi's. It was a very left-leaning company, but primarily the policies that were left-leaning were sort of directed inwards up until a certain point. So we integrated factories. I still say we. They integrated factories in the South before the law required it, same-sex partner benefits in 1992. These were very sort of progressive stances, but again, it was about taking care of employees. And I thought that was great. I was very proud of that, to work at a company that had done that, despite protests from consumers and even some employees. Somewhere in the mid-2010s, we started to kind of turn that outward. And I was definitely part of it, taking these more outward stances. And I think, look, some of it's good, right? Some of it's about inclusion. It's like we are for everyone. We are for every, like, I think it's good if we take a sort of a fraught, but maybe less fraught than some things, body positivity. We started to show women in our ads that weren't all, a size 2 and 6 foot 3, which is what it used to be, which I think is a good thing. You're sort of speaking to a broader audience. But I think it's all really gone way too far. And I think you're excluding 50% of the country who doesn't hold the views. If you're taking an aggressive, if you're doing a Pride Month campaign that is aggressively, I don't know. I don't even know. I'm not going to give an example. But you're also alienating a lot of the employees. It's like they forget the executives because they live in San Francisco and everybody they know agrees with them. But you know what? At Levi's, there's stores in all 50 states. There's distribution centers in places like Kentucky and Las Vegas, and there's another office in Texas. Those people felt completely alienated and like they weren't really part of the community and the culture. And so that's another problem in a company that's talking about, oh, we're all about inclusion, but only if you agree with us. And I just firmly, I believe companies should get back to, I call it normie capitalism in the book. Just market the products, make a great product, sell it at a fair price, market it in an aspirational way, and focus, get back to focusing on treating your employees fairly and treating them well, because it's the hypocrisy that makes me crazy. All these companies, Nike's a good example, doing these Women's History Month campaigns. Meanwhile, internally, they're sexually harassing women and not paying pregnant athletes. And it's the charade of it all that I find most egregious.
Well, to me, they are using social issues as marketing, and it is
That's
something
right.
that I don't doesn't sit quite right with me. So, like the things that you mentioned, like giving same-sex partners say good benefit the same benefits as non-same-sex partners, or even including different people in campaigns. I mean, those are that's all fine, but for
Right.
me to or all. Treating employees well, those kinds of things are great. But when you're dealing with something that's really promoting a social issue in order to sell your product, I think that's where you're kind of getting into a very different space. And it
I agree.
feels like exploitative. Yeah.
I
And
agree. It is exploitative. It make no mistake, that is the point. It is not a cynical view. It is truthful. I have been in the boardrooms. I have been in executive rooms. The point of it is to align yourself as a brand and a business with the values of Gen Z and millennials, or their perceived values, and sell them more stuff by saying we're like you. That's the point. That is the whole point.
Yeah, because I feel like if you're, maybe if you're an owner of a company that individually runs it, like those can be your values and you sincerely believe it and therefore you're doing it. But then you're probably not even going to advertise it in that way. I love a company
Right.
like Newman's Own, for example, where they just quietly donate, it all
Right.
goes to charity, right? And I love that. But there isn't this like we're doing this. Well, you know what I'm talking about. I
I do
just
know.
feel, yeah.
If it were, look, I actually don't, I mean, I don't think it's good business, because I think you're sort of, one, it's distracting, two, it's dishonest. And by
Yes.
distracting, I mean, the last couple of years of the company, I was just batting away requests from employees constantly, like, why don't we take a stand on this? Why don't we take a stand on that? I'm like, I don't know. I'm trying to launch the new bootcut jean. Like, I'm busy here. Leave me alone. We don't have to make a statement about everything that happens in the world. Our job is actually to sell product. That's our job. Some companies put a stake in the ground and they're willing to actually take real risks because of it. So, I think Ben and Jerry's is one example. Fine, if that's what you're going to stake your reputation on, that is not Levi's and that is not Nike. It's all a game and a show, and it's meant to distract, and they love being celebrated as social justice warriors because it's not that cool to be rich, right? You're a jerk if you're that rich and that privileged, but they actually want to be that rich and privileged and also celebrated by their own children and by Gen Zs as social justice warriors.
And
But
of
at the
course, they
end of
go and do
the
terrible things in other countries most of the time, too.
day, exactly. I mean, it's like, the FTX guy, Sam Bankman-Fried, said it. He said, it's a game we woke Westerners play so people like us. Game over. He said it out loud. That's all it is. During COVID, we laid off 15% of our workforce at Levi's because business was tough for a time. And the CEO cashed out $43 million worth of stock.
And they probably said, we're all in this together.
They said, we're doing this with empathy. We're in this together. No, we're not. That's the crux of it. And that's why it's a lie, it's a charade. And I just think regular old selling stuff, normie capitalism, is more honest. And if you focus your time and energy on treating workers fairly, raise the minimum, maybe focus on getting the minimum wage raised. They don't want to do that.
The Container Store is actually kind of an interesting example of paying people. I think they pay people at least $50,000. They have way less employees, but they do, so they probably work a lot harder, but they have $50,000 salaries, and it seems to work really well. So, I mean,
I think
it's interesting.
another, if I were to lead a company, I think another, no one will let me do it because I'm saying this right now, but well, and for a million other reasons, but the ratio of CEO compensation to average worker compensation has
Yeah.
increased like unimaginably in the last 20 or 30 years. So a CEO on average makes something like 350 times that of the average employee. What if you kind of brought that back to where it was 20 or 30 years ago? You would retain the same level of profitability for the company. The CEO would still be very rich. He'd still probably make 50 to 100 times what the average employee makes, but the average employees would all be paid a better wage. You know, companies claim they can't do that because they won't attract top talent, because of course the top talent all wants to.
Why did it balloon so much? Because it did go up so much. Is it like, what caused it to balloon so much?
It's a great question. I'm not sure I have the answer. I mean, I wasn't, you know, in the corporate world back in the 70s and 80s. I assume greedy executives. That's what caused it.
I mean, imagine they just kept trying to up their salaries to a point where, I mean, high tech didn't used to pay that much either. And now, like, you could be right out of, you know, if you're, you know, a computer engineer, right out of university, right, you can get, you know, 200 grand and then 500 grand for your next job. And that didn't used to be the case. It's just very competitive, I guess. But
but they did it. I mean, the CEOs, you know, appoint the board members. The board members do what the CEOs want, which is approve the executive compensation. And it's just this big, like, everybody's greasing each other's palms. And it used to be, you know, back in the day, I mean, now I'm going back 100 years, but Henry Ford wanted to make a car that every employee could afford. That was part of the goal and the mission of the company, to make a great car that every employee and every person could afford. No one thinks that way anymore. And yet they make a big show of being do-gooders and altruists and their company having values and a soul. Companies don't have souls. Companies exist to make money.
Companies are psychopaths, as there's a great documentary called I've seen The Corporation. Yeah.
Yeah.
I do believe that more and more. I mean, it is the inherent structure of a corporation. So it makes sense. The people within the company could be, you know, wanting to do good, and sometimes good things are done by companies by accident, or because some individuals might push good ideas through. But
you know what? It's as an executive of a company, as an executive officer, which I was, it's your fiduciary responsibility to drive a profit for the company. We always said that we wanted to drive profits through principles and do that ethically. I thought that we did for a time. I no longer think that necessarily. But you're right, companies can do good. I think this idea, all these companies sort of claiming to kind of want to change the world, that's where alarm bells should go off. You know how companies can do good in the world? They can treat their employees fairly, pay them a great wage that is, you know, allows them to live a decent life, give them good benefits, give them paid maternity leave and disability leave, all those things. Like, that does a lot of good in the world. If every company focused on doing right by their employees and making a good product that serves consumers, that actually does make a difference. And some companies are focused on that. It's the ones that do all the arm waving about changing the world. Those are the ones that you should not trust.
And preferably they can make products that last more than a few months, so we don't end up having to throw them away. That would be nice. And the other thing is, like, we've changed. I mean, people don't stay, like you said, like, people, you've stayed at your job for a very long time. That is quite unusual now. So, and that part of that is that companies do treat employees as disposable. And then that causes the employees not to have very much loyalty. And they know that to grow within a company, or to grow in their careers rather, or their salaries, they need to switch jobs every couple of years. So that creates a certain kind of an environment too. So all of these things, I think, contribute.
Yeah. And I think it's worse now. You know, I mean, one of the reasons I stayed at Levi's so long was I did love the culture and the connections. And I felt like the culture was really unique. But as people work from home more and more, we're all gig workers. No one cares. You're not connected. Turnover goes up. That's expensive for a company. But it is also true. You're right. most people, and they're right, feel like they need to leave to actually get paid fair market value for their job. I actually was in a meeting once at Levi's. This is how naive I was, even after 10 or 11 years at the company. We were debating whether to kind of go outside to find someone new for a role or hire the intern, you know, the internal candidate. And everybody voted on the internal because they said, well, it's cheaper. And I said, well, we should pay the person what they're worth. Like, if we think we have to pay the external, we should pay the internal that. Well, no, the reason, this is what they told me, the reason you bring in the internal is it's cheaper. And I was like, that's gross. I mean, here I was 40 years old. This is how naive. It takes me a while to catch on. I catch on eventually. So yeah, people feel like they have to leave to get paid what they're worth.
Yeah, and that's definitely unfortunate. Well, when you ended up leaving, I was trying to do scarecrow, and they were out of frame. But when you ended up leaving Levi's, you were offered a $1 million severance package, which you turned down so you can speak freely, not have to sign a non-disclosure agreement. Were you at any point tempted to take it?
Yeah, but not for very long, like fleeting. It didn't take me long to know that I was not going to take it. I mean, I certainly thought about it. I have four kids, two in college. You know, it certainly would make life a little easier. I mean, the other thing is if I had signed a non-disclosure and wasn't so outspoken, it would probably be easier for me to get another job as well. So, but I just, you know, while I started speaking out to advocate for children, it became clearer and clearer to me that this issue of speech and open debate and dissent, and that was really the kind of core root cause of the problem we were having. I mean, the fact is if we've been able to talk about this issue with kids in schools and good doctors weren't blacklisted and silenced and smeared, schools would have opened sooner. I mean, that's the fundamental issue here. I mean, we can't have these conversations and good people with good intentions are silenced because they're just called the most terrible, unemployable things. We don't get to good answers. And then here we are and the kids are harmed. So speech became very much one of the things I was outspoken about. And it just felt too hypocritical to silence myself, even for money.
Why do you think speech is under attack the way it is, you know, whether it is by sort of corporate powers or just people getting so angry when you say something that's kind of dissenting? There does seem to be this significant intolerance towards, you know, dissenting views, points, instead of just, you know, disagreeing, arguing with something. Yeah. There is this kind of tendency towards silencing. Where do you think that comes from in our culture? Because it does seem to have gotten more extreme.
Yeah, it's definitely accelerated. I have lots of thoughts. Why do you think it happened? I'll ask you first.
Oh, gosh. Well, now I'm on the spot. Damn, I wanted an easy answer from you.
Okay, I don't have an easy one. I think it's a confluence, honestly. I think the culture of safetyism and how my generation has raised their children, I think, contributes to it. You know, people expect speech is violence. I don't have to hear things I don't like. If you say a thing I don't like, that is putting me at actual physical risk. That is a lie and that's false. And, you know, we raised our children Gen X, to believe that. I didn't raise my children that way, but, you know, we all know about it. And they then went through high school and then they went to college and experienced safe spaces and really think any sort of minor grievance they may have is a grave social injustice. And those kids are now going to work in companies. And so what started on college campuses is coming into companies. I think that's part of it, this excessive safetyism. I think in the United States, just Trump drove the country mad. And I really think that it was happening before, but that just accelerated it all. It was like, no, we will brook no dissent anymore. He is so evil that he must be stopped. Trump derangement syndrome, you know, and you know, when it comes to schools, it's like the summer of 2020 and he said schools should open. I was like, now they're never opening. because anything he that man is considered so evil and so dangerous, and mostly I believe he's a buffoon more than anything, but was considered so evil and so dangerous that you had to oppose him with every fiber of your being. And then that kind of developed into this extreme tribalism within the parties, because it wasn't like that before. I mean, I remember there was a time when you could be a pro-choice Republican or you could be a pro-life Democrat. That cannot exist anymore. You tick every box on the party platform or you are evil and you are banished. So I think Trump had a lot to do with it. I know it was happening before that, but I think that was just like a line in the sand. And then everything just went bonkers.
I definitely saw the acceleration in 2016 for sure. I think that division, I think made people sort of go more into their silos and, and not want to engage with anyone outside of it. And I've also kind of reflected more recently, and like, okay, I've never really had much of an issue engaging with people who disagree with me. And why is that? Oh, I'm like, okay, you know what? It's because around the dinner table, I always fought with my family. We hardly ever agree on anything. Yeah. I think if you grew up in that environment, you just have a different attitude in general about these things. So if you're disagreeing with your family all the time and fighting, but you still love each other and, you know, you still talk to each other, like that's never an option to, like, you hear about people having, you know, not seeing each other for Thanksgiving because of some disagreement over some politics. Like that idea is just unfathomable, right?
Yeah, well, no, because that's how my family is right now. But, you know, the other issue is we've become so kind of how we choose to live is so compartmentalized. I mean, I lived in San Francisco for over 30 years. I never met or knew a single conservative that lived there. I didn't know one person. People move there because they don't want to have to interact with someone that is. Now, I knew some from growing up and people I went to high school with. You know, I grew up in Pennsylvania in a more conservative Catholic community. I'm not Catholic, I'm Jewish, but that's where I grew up. And so I had some of those inputs. But I think a lot of people, they are so in a bubble. They never talk to anyone that disagrees with them on anything, and they're able to convince themselves that those people are evil. And then of course the media lends itself to that in the way that it is divided now as well. So if you are a liberal in San Francisco and all you watch is MSNBC and Rachel Maddow, you think anyone who said the things I said has like a white hood in her closet and that, you know, I'm going to Klan rallies on the weekend.
I think the media played a big role too, because the media became took on a much more activist role, and that is what sort of reflects our reality to us. Especially when you don't know, like you, I lived in New York, I lived in other cities that were like quite liberal. I to be honest, I didn't really know any conservatives myself either. It wasn't really in my realm. So there is a part of me, even though I was maybe a little more open-minded, a little less judgy about people who might be conservative or Republican, I think I was more curious maybe than judgy. Judgmental. I didn't know. Yeah. Well, there's still a part of me that was, because I still internalize what I would hear about, you know, what they believed about things. Right. So I still assumed that everyone was very like religious and very pro this, you know, pro life. And maybe there was more racism and things like that. I think I still kind of were more inclined to believe that. And then once I started talking to people and asking them questions, I realized, well, people's beliefs were all over the place. I mean, some people are extraordinarily racist and think that Jews killed Jesus and all these things and all the stereotypes. And some people are way more moderate than you might think and have, you know, we can actually agree on a lot of issues. But people don't bother asking the other side, so to speak, what is it that you believe? And they assume.
They Well, and they assume it's evil. I mean, I have friends that are pro-life. I understand the perspective. I would, if I go into, I don't agree. But if I don't go into a conversation with an open mind and I just assume this person is a misogynist that doesn't want women to have any rights at all, wants, you know, to take away any and all bodily autonomy. But if I listen, I can understand a bit better and we can find some connection. And in fact, my views on this subject have changed. I am not pro-life, but I am also not a abortion until, you know, birth. I the world has changed. Birth control is much more available and there are all sorts of options that you, and I understand that there are sort of egregious circumstances where sometimes you, at 30 some odd weeks, you might need to, which is why I always sort of would vote in favor of the woman and her doctor making the decision.
I suspect that you and I have arrived at a similar point of view after considering this.
I mean, I think at the end of the day, I've had 4 children. Mm-hmm. You do hear the heartbeat. Whatever they say, it's not the heartbeat. 10 weeks, you know if it's a baby. You know. Yeah. And the other part of this whole debate, which I just think is crazy, is something like 90% of abortions are happening at 12, 13, or 14 weeks anyway. So why are we all arguing the like edge cases that aren't really kind of, but anyway, I don't want to get into it. A whole sort of choice life thing. But I have friends that are pro-life. I try to approach every conversation with an open mind so that I can understand. I have friends that are religious. I am not religious. That probably won't change anytime soon. But I have to say, my view on sort of religiousness has changed as well. And I think a lot of the people that I stood with during COVID in this sort of fight for children were religious. And I think that what I've come to appreciate is there's a real respect for the sort of, they would call it the soul, but sort of like the spirit and the individualism of each person, each child. And that we shouldn't flatten people into groups and all do things for the group, or at least these are the people that I've come to know. And I know religion can be used for all sorts of horrible ends as well. I understand that, but there's just this, you know, the people that I've encountered and become friends with, there's this real sort of appreciation for our humanity and our, you know, that you can't isolate people and force them to be alone and tell them they have to do this because it's for other people. Like the spirit and the soul, it matters. And we're social beings and we need to be together. But the, you know, the religions failed. The houses of worship were all closed. And that's a real tragedy as well. Many groups failed. The libertarians failed. The religious groups failed. Everybody
just failed.
Everybody failed. Anyway. Well, I think it's good to talk to people you disagree with on all kinds of stuff.
I agree because it pushes, it teaches you things and it challenges your own beliefs and makes you better, I think. Well,
has your opinion evolved on it? It's like, did you used to think one thing on this sort of choice, but you've evolved probably
a lot. Yeah, lot. But I evolve a lot. I don't have a very difficult time changing my views. In fact, I think that's like my weak point sometimes. I don't have a lot of certainty. So in some ways it's a strength and sometimes it can be a weakness because there's like less certainty in things. And when you have less certainty in things, it's harder to act on things. But yeah. So sometimes it's doubt can be a little crippling, I suppose. But
but the good thing about the good thing, that's what I was gonna say is, you know what, new information can present itself as well, and being open to that is really, really important.
Like the pro-life, pro-choice conundrum, you know, where I've definitely changed a lot of my views on that. And, you know, even there, like, because I thought that the pro-life side only believed, the only argument I would hear was sort of the religious argument. Now I get this very different other side and it, you know, it makes sense. It's completely logical too. Yeah, I haven't completely changed my view on it, but I've changed some of it. And I realized, well, there's really no settling it. Ultimately, it's going to be more aligned with your moral standing of what you value. It's kind of emotional in some ways.
It is. But I guess here's the thing is apparently in the United States, at least, I can't speak for Canada, over 70% of people actually agree that it should be legal with restrictions, those restrictions being around sort of how far along in your pregnancy you are, that kind of thing. And restrictions that very much align with most European countries. It's the parties and the party leadership that politicize it, because 3/4 of Americans agree and have very common sense views on it. But the parties make it so extreme and force you to sort of fully, it has to be abortion bill 40 weeks or you hate women, or no abortions ever, or you're a child murderer.
Because they use it as a marketing tool, just like that's the corporations do. And that's the thing. I've talked to conservatives. I think most moderate people, it's the parties and it's the extremists, right? So, and we need to stop listening to both, really, because I think most people, when they get together, I think we can find a lot of compromises. And I think we can come to something that would appease most people. We are not going to appease everybody, but I think most people are going to agree. And I'm pretty sure I know what most people will be okay with. And so most reasonable people, I think we really can find a lot of common ground.
I agree. Yeah. And most are willing to compromise. Even conservative people I know, they know that it's not popular or particularly realistic to say no, even if that's what they would want, and they know abortion ever, most would agree on some sort of time constraint in the sort of
almost every single person, if not every single person who's more of a moderate conservative that I've talked to is willing to compromise. And most people who are pro choice or not extremists who are reasonable people will agree on the same measure. So it really shouldn't be where it is now, but it is being used as a tool.
Crazy.
And I realize how many of these things are like that. And it's just sad that that's where we are, but it's very frustrating.
It's probably time to wrap, but that is the thing. Most common sense people agree on all of these like extremely controversial issues. And I'm not going to go down the rabbit hole of, gender youth transition and gender ideology. But again, I think most reasonable people can agree on what the sort of common sense path here is. And yet it is so polarized and so binary because of the extremes on either side that the common sense folks in the middle are too afraid to say anything. Nobody will say anything.
Yeah. And because they're afraid to have these conversations, which is, part of why I'm having these conversations.
That is why I didn't sign the non-disclosure agreement, because we have to have these conversations. We have to. It was common sense from the beginning that children should not be locked out of school for 2 years. It just was.
Well, when all of this happened, there was a lot of media attention, obviously, and you had a lot of write-ups, New York Times and other places. I imagine that did affect, at least in some small way, your professional reputation. And, and I don't know if I assume you're no longer in the corporate sector. And I'm wondering if you could still be if you wanted to, or what's your work situation like? What is life after all of this in the aftermath?
Well, it's actually 1 year tomorrow since I resigned resigned / got shoved out the door. I spent the summer writing the book that came out in the fall. So I wrote it pretty fast, and I'm making a documentary film about the impact of children from the school closures. Right after I quit and it was in the news, I did get quite a few calls from companies that actually wanted me because of my outspokenness, and I was just not in any shape to go back into the corporate world. I was really, it had been a tough couple of years. I wanted a little bit of a break. So now I'm starting to think about what's next, and I do some consulting. So when I get a call, it's because they say, I like what you stand for. And I think that on this particular issue and what I was outspoken, the consensus is moving so fast that it was wrong to place these onerous restrictions on children, that I think it won't be too far in the future where I'm considered an okay person to have come work at a company. I mean, the problem is, because most folks, and I get a lot of emails and texts from other CEOs saying, you were right, we're cheering you on, but they won't say that publicly yet. Like, they're still afraid. And I think the thing that is scary about me is I don't obey orders. And in a company, that's not necessarily embraced. But I actually, you know, if I were a betting woman, I would say I ultimately will end up probably working in a company again. I think somebody will want me.
And now that you've unleashed your voice, do you feel happier, freer?
I do. Like, I never have to watch what I say. I don't have to self-censor. Because as outspoken as I was so careful. I never really said exactly what I thought, you know, and now I say exactly what I think. I mean, it's a little nerve-wracking because I still am the primary breadwinner for my family. So I got to figure that out. And I'm not, you know, I'm young enough that I have to keep working. But it's a relief. The irony, though, is even, you know, for me and I'm sure for you, there's still things that I pause and go, oh, maybe I shouldn't say that. I'm in enough hot water already. You know, like, I still suppose I self-censor some.
Well, thank
I'm trying
you
not to.
Me too.
Yeah.
But thank you so much for having this conversation with me. I really appreciate you joining and lending your voice.
Thank you for having me. I enjoyed chatting with you, and I enjoy your thoughts on Twitter and in Twitter Spaces.
Oh, really appreciate that. Oh, you hear those?
I hear. I sometimes listen in. I've never spoken. I sometimes listen in.
I'll have to be more articulate now that I know that.
Oh, no, you're always great. You're great.
Well, thank you so much. And by the way, I will tell you something. I'll end this.